Hello everyone, and welcome once again to Stitch Bliss Corner. Mary Rose here. I'd just like to say hello to all my subscribers. If you're here for the first time, welcome. Thank you for all the questions that I get and all the comments that I get. I enjoy seeing each and every one of them. I just want to mention something about the last video I made. I mentioned Shakespeare. I thought I'd just give you the full quote. It was from The Merchant of Venice, and Portia does these lines. And it's, "The quality of mercy is not strained. It droppeth as the gentle rain from heaven upon the place beneath. It is twice blessed. It blesseth him that gives and him that takes." So, the timeless Shakespeare. Now, I don't pretend to know a lot about samplers. In fact, it was a standing start, and that's what I'm going to talk about today. And I looked into them to see what I could find out. So most of the information I've got is from the Victorian and Albert Museum website, and some other links that I will put below. So I thought I'd just, it's more of an outline really, so that you can get a bit of an idea of how samplers reflected the social history of the times quite a bit. And I think it's one of the links again that we have, the tangible links that we have to the past, that can make us more reflective about how things used to be and how much better things are today with hygiene and things that we take for granted these days were just dreams to people in the past. So anyway, one of the things I started with was to look at the early samplers. And you know how when you look at a sampler, you look at the fabric and the threads and of course the motifs and the patterns within, but you can forget about the needles. And a German man, Elias Krause, C-R-O-W-S-E, in 1556 introduced Spanish needles into England. This led to an increase in popularity of embroidery. I didn't know that. I do now. So that's an interesting point too, isn't it? Because we all value certain needles. You know, there are ones that you look for to make sure that you don't lose it, you know, that a favoured needle. So I thought that was interesting. Now, I've got here that I've got quite a bit of paperwork here, and I'm going to try not to repeat myself. But it's not like Henry VIII and Mary Queen of Scots, where I had a bedrock to work with of knowledge. This wasn't like that. So if I repeat myself, I do apologise in advance for that. Now, samplers derive their English name from the French sampler, that's E-S-S-A-M-P-L-A-I-R, meaning any kind of work to be copied or imitated. The earliest samplers were put together as personal reference works of motifs and stitches and patterns before printed patterns came along, so that they could be recreated by others. These reference works would have been stitched by adults, not children. So each lady or woman or girl who saw a pattern or a motif on a sampler that she liked. Because pattern books were either non-existent or rare or very expensive and rare, they used to have some fabric with them and they would copy a pattern or a motif from an existing sampler so that they could put it on their own work later. Might be a shirt, you know, a lot of the Elizabethan shirts men wore were very ornate, as you know. So if they saw a design that they liked, they would want to make a record of it. I should imagine some women were very good at that because they might have had a very good memory. And so they'd only need a few stitches to jog their memory as to the motif that they were going to be embroidering on something else. Whereas someone else would have taken quite a bit of time to copy a motif. So I thought that was interesting. And it says here, according to John Pelsgrave's Anglo-French Dictionary of 1530, the exemplar was a source for women to refer to of patterns and stitches before the availability of printed designs. The first printed pattern book was published by Johann, that's J-O-H-A-N-N, Schönsberger, that's S-C-H-O-N-S-P-E-R-G-E-R, in Augsburg, Germany. It was followed by Italy, France and England, borrowing extensively from each other with no acknowledgement of each other. The earliest motifs were often ecclesiastical. Printed patterns were very expensive, so the stitch sampler was used as a reference for a very long time. And fabric was so expensive that they tended to cram everything onto a piece of cloth with all the different band designs and everything else, which is understandable. It's a bit like if paper is short, you know, you don't waste paper. Well, it's the same with the material. Let's see. Yes, it's hard to say when the first samplers began because no names or dates were usually recorded at first. And spot motifs were on the first fabric of samplers, just randomly placed on the cloth. And then rows of letters and borders came later. I'll just put that one there for the moment. There are surviving samplers of the 1600s, but they are very rare. Jane Bostock, 1598, she made the earliest known English example to include an embroidered date. Its inscription commemorates the birth of a child, Alice Lee, 2 years earlier. Now, I do have a picture here, but I should imagine that if you want to see these, of course, it's better to have a look on the internet and then you can see them better. Because they're not, you know, it's not easy to see them on the... That's Jane Bostock's sampler. And it's really... It's metallic thread, silk and metallic thread. And the writing, the Alice Lee part, is along there. So that was Jane's. Let's see now. As printed patterns became cheaper and more widely available, the sampler developed into an example of individual stitches' ability and constancy to purpose. The sampler has two elements of needlework exercise in it. The individual motives, or motifs I should say, usually described as spot samplers. So there were two different samplers. There was the spot sampler that had all the individual motifs on it. And then there was the band sampler that just had rows and rows and rows of patterned borders. And eventually they came together with lettering and everything else to form a sampler. In the 17th century, so-called spot samplers had a close association with the earlier sampler reference pieces that preceded them. They were used for reference for clothes, etc. You know, the men's beautiful clothes and the women's clothes as well. By 1630, the characteristic shape of the sampler developed, and the loom determined the width of the piece and how long the piece was. The selvages formed the top and bottom edges of the sampler. So a lot of them were narrow because of the way the looms were, the early ones. Now, according to Wikipedia, a needlework sampler is a piece of embroidery or cross-stitching produced as a demonstration of a test of skill in needlework. It often includes alphabet, figures, motifs, decorative border, and sometimes the name of the stitcher. The word sampler is derived from the Latin exemplum, an example. The earliest so far is a spot sampler from Peru. It was worked in cotton and wool pattern, darning on a woven cotton ground. It has 74 figures of birds, plants, and mythological beings. 74. Samplers were known to be used by stitchers in Europe as early as the beginning of the 16th century, but none have survived. A collection of 50 samplers was listed in the 1509 inventory of the possessions of Queen Juana of Spain, but they have all disappeared. The oldest surviving European samplers were stitched in the 16th and 17th centuries. As there were few pre-printed patterns available for stitchers, a stitch model was needed, so on and so forth. Now, Jane Bostock sampler, the one I mentioned earlier and I showed you, it says that Alice Lee was born on the 23rd of November, being Tuesday, in the afternoon, 1596. It was on linen, that particular one. Now, there are... A sampler in the Museum of London has two cutwork bands. I've got some pictures to show you. In silk, gold and silver threads. 13 bands of reticella, white work, in white linen thread. The fourth band from the top has the initials ER and the royal coats of arms of Queen Elizabeth I. And the maker's name was Susan Negabry, in bold letters. It is believed to date before the Queen's death in 1603. Because there were few surviving samplers from the 16th century, it is not possible to generalise their appearance and style. By the mid-17th century, English, Dutch and German samplers were being stitched on a narrow band of fabric, 6 to 9 inches or 150 to 230 millimetres wide. As fabric was very expensive, these samplers were covered with neat rows of stitches. They were called band samplers and highly valued and passed down through the generations. The samplers used a variety of needlework styles, threads and ornament, many very elaborate with silk, metallics and stitches, such as Hungarian, Florentine, Algerian, long arm cross stitch, two-sided Italian cross. I've got some pictures here of some of the stitches used. Samplers also incorporated small designs of flowers, animals, geometric designs, using as many as 20 different colours of threads. Band samplers were more decorative than the utilitarian spot sampler. In the late 17th and 18th centuries, sampler designs changed as they entered the school curriculum. Alphabets and verses, along with pictorial elements such as architectural motifs and landscapes. Educational themes included maps, multiplication tables, perpetual calendars, and acrostic puzzles, and Also, there were a lot of sayings around virtues, you know, what you should. And I suppose as young girls were stitching these biblical passages and advice on being a proper young lady, it would have gone into the subconscious. You know, I mean, it's not like you just write it down and that's it. You're there stitching for hours. So I suppose in that way, it did condition the mind of a lot of the stitching girls about that what was expected of them as girls of that era. By the 18th century, samplers were very different to the earlier scattered sampler. They became wider and more square, eventually with borders on all four sides. Samplers were mainly school exercises during the 18th and 19th century and worked almost entirely in cross-stitch. Berlin woolwork became popular worldwide, and they were stitched more to demonstrate knowledge than to preserve skill, because they had printed patterns and, you know, you used canvas and tent stitch more for the Berlin woolwork, which got to be very popular. The stitching of samplers was believed to be a sign of virtue, achievement and industry, and girls were taught the art from a young age. Berlin woolwork designs had naturalistic shading and more depth of perspective than the flat two-dimensional objects in traditional needlework. By mid-19th century, adult stitchers were devising long and narrow stitch samplers having geometric patterns done in woolwork, which I think I've got some of that here somewhere. Okay, now I'll just show you some of the stitches that were used. There was chevron stitch, that one there was quite popular. Then Florentine stitch. Hungarian stitch. Oh yes, and there's Algerian, yeah. And the Algerian eye stitch. And this is from Embroidery Stitches, Mary Webb. Right now, I'll be on to some pictures of samplers, and as things occur, I'll let you know if I found out anything. Now, this is from Jeff Genealogy, and it's just something to keep in mind here, because he says that in England and Wales, the child mortality peaked in the 1890s, 150 deaths for every 1,000 births. There were diseases like smallpox, whooping cough, cholera, typhus, diarrhea, and whooping cough is, it's just dreadful. I don't know if a lot of people today wouldn't have seen it, but whooping cough is where a child, usually, you know, very young, 2 or 3 years old, they cough, and they just keep coughing. And you're waiting for them to breathe, and they just get right to the end, and then suddenly there's a big whooping sound as they finally are able to breathe in. And it's just appalling to see a child with, I only saw one child with that, and it was just terrible. Anyway, and one of the reasons for all these diseases was the very poor living conditions of the Victorian times, and times before that, of course. Lack of sanitation and clean water. And of course, children were sent down the mines. They went up chimneys to help the chimney sweeps, and because of their size, they could get inside the big chimneys in the old, big old houses and everything. A lot of families lost children and a parent. So therefore, death was always nearby. It wasn't something that was not talked about. It was talked about a lot. And the virtues and believing in God and being God-fearing and being good as a child were emphasized, because they never knew when they were going to suddenly die. So, you know, people say, oh, they were very morbid, the Victorians are always talking about death. But death was always with them. It wasn't as though they were purposely being morbid. And there were lots of people there when someone was dying, you know, and it's sort of like modern life is reversed now. I mean, it's like everyone's at the birth of a child, and not many people are there when someone goes. But in Victorian times, there weren't many people at birth, but there were plenty of people when someone was dying. And, you know, they have photographs of living people with a dead person in the photograph from Victorian times, to make a record of that person. And they had special stands in the photographic studios so that someone who was deceased could look as though they were sitting in a chair or standing even next to someone. And they didn't see that as being in any way macabre. They saw it as just, well, that person has moved over to the other side. But we'll make a recording of that person with a photograph. Oh, sorry, I just got off the track there a little bit. But anyway, to get back to this. Now, health improved after the Public Health Acts and vaccination came in. And Edward Jenner was the big pioneer of immunisation. And he noticed that the girls that milked the cows didn't used to get smallpox, which was a terrible disease. They used to get cowpox, which was a milder version of smallpox, and it made them immune to the very virulent smallpox infection. So Edward Jenner, I've just got a picture of him here somewhere, just hang on a check. That's him there. And here he is, injected. Well, he didn't really inject the child. What he did, he got some pus from the hands of the girls that used to milk the cows and made some scratches on the child's arm, which injected or inoculated in the cowpox. And the child got the infection from the cowpox, a mild infection, but thereafter was immune to smallpox. And it was his gardener's son, James Phipps, 8 years old. Right, now then, have a look at some of the samplers now. Now, I've got some notes here, not surprisingly. Now, there's the cover of this book, and this is Traditional Samplers by Sarah Don. And the jacket picture here, the Lamb of God, a sampler using simple stitches and colour to create a large number of patterns and textures. The central design is a Dutch motif, the Lamb of God. Now, according to Sarah Don, she says by the 18th century, samplers were the means by which young girls learnt the skills of needlework. Later in schools, they became useful exercises for teaching. Poor children in schools and orphanages were taught only the most basic skills and worked row on row of alphabets and numerals onto their samplers. It was hoped that these children would eventually gain employment in service, having become proficient in the marking of linen, darning, and mending. And of course, the people, the upstairs people, because these domestic staff all live downstairs in cramped quarters, the upstairs people would have sons going to boarding school that all needed names on their clothes. Handkerchiefs needed to be embroidered, you know, the initials of the man of the house on all his handkerchiefs. The ladies' hankies, I mean, I suppose they would have stitched a lot of them themselves, but there may have been some task like their initials that they left to their staff to embroider. Darning needed to be done. A lot of the ladies' clothes, you know, I mean, before sewing machines, hours and hours of work was done in, you know, hovels, I suppose, around these big houses in London and places like that. You would have had rooms where girls and women spent hours stitching clothes for the women that had means to pay them, and probably didn't pay them very much as well. So here are some samplers. This one here is a Spanish sampler showing a large number of geometric border patterns worked mostly in satin stitch. This one, make sure I've got this correct here. Yes, there it is there. That's her sampler. And her name was Gertrude de Opezo. It was dated 1729. Materials used silk on linen, 36 by 26 and a half inches, or 91.4 by 67 centimetres. The Victoria and Albert Museum. And you can see how close together all that is. Quite exquisite borders and wonderful stuff. This book, oh, is once again Sarah Don. I'm just going through hers. An English sampler, early 17th century, with numerous spot motifs and geometric patterns. Threads used are silver, silver gilt, and silk on linen. And we have some animals here. A frog, a caterpillar, a duck, a fish, butterflies, and I think there's a millipede or a centipede as well that I spotted. Now, some of these animals aren't easy to see. There's the butterfly, I presume. Another butterfly there. Caterpillar. I think that, don't you think that looks a bit like a millipede or a centipede? But it looks random, doesn't it? That's a very good example of a spot sampler. I think that's a bit of a CC work just there. Just that one. Alright, so that's that one. And here is an example of an English band sampler of the mid-17th century, which has a number of motifs worked in double running stitch and wide floral bands of patterning. Our life is never at a stand, 'tis like a fading flower. Death is always near at hand, comes nearer every hour. You needed to be heaven ready. That's what I think. And there's some cut work there. And what does this say here? Italian white work. Sampler of the mid 17th century, which is signed Gvilla. I'll just do her last name. P-I-C-C-O-L-O-M-I-N-I. A number of intricate and rather lovely geometric patterns have been worked in cut and drawn thread work using linen on linen. A female figure has been included in the bottom left-hand corner. Now, many samplers showed the old alphabet from which J and U were omitted, with I and V being used in their place. Q was often the same as P, but reversed. Z was often omitted altogether as a letter not much in use. Alphabets were usually laid out in rows, being worked across the sampler and divided by lines of border patterns varying in design, size and complexity. Letters were occasionally worked in pairs. I don't really know why that's on that page, because there aren't any letters there, but I've got some later on. That particular sampler there is a charming little sampler of the mid-18th century, designed by Hannah Haynes, and has cut work with holly point insertions. All right, here's a, whoa. That's certainly, this sample was worked by M.A. Tipper and includes the following inscription. M.A. Tipper, New Orphan House, North Wing, Ashley Down, Bristol, 1868. The 6 was later changed to O to make the sampler seem earlier. That would have taken quite a bit of work, wouldn't it? Preparing that child for a life in service, I would think. M.A. Tipper was born in 16 September 1852 and was admitted to the orphanage in 1863, aged 11 years. This piece shows the purely fictional purpose of samplers to teach children the basic skills of sewing alphabets and numerals for marking linen. Nevertheless, this sampler must have been quite a feat, taking many hours to complete. Well, would have taken a long time. Okay, so that's that one. Now, what have I got here? Oh, a human hair sampler from Annie Parker. Schools took in plain work, usually darning or repairing worn linen. The profits were to help fund the school. So there's some human hair used in that one. And I think that was not uncommon. I won't show you long this one here because it's a Bronte sister one, and I've got a close up of that later on, which I'll show you. Now I got some information from the National Museum of American History, and they say the earliest known American sampler was made by Loara, L-O-A-R-A, Standish of the New Plymouth Colony about 1645. By the 1700s, samplers depicting alphabets and numerals were worked by young women to learn the basic needlework skills needed to operate the family household. By the late 1700s and early 1800s, schools and academies for well-to-do young women flourished, and more elaborate pieces and decorative motifs, such as verses, flowers, houses, religious, pastoral, and or mourning scenes, that's M-O-U-R-N-I-N-G scenes, were being stitched. In recent years, samplers have become important in museum collections as representations of early American female education. Many are signed, some are inscribed with the names of teachers and schools. Many early samplers do not have the letters J and U in their alphabets because they were not part of the early Latin alphabet, and so the letter I was used for J and V for the letter U. The letter S is often replaced with the printer's S, which looks like the modern F. And it's got here, samplers and the art of sampler making came to America with the early settlers, and most colonial women took their needlework very seriously. Mothers took great pride in their work and taught their daughters the art of stitching. The resulting samplers were hung in the parlor as proof of the daughter's ability to produce fine needlework. Darning, mending, and marking were still important tasks in the home, and girls were not considered marriageable until they had mastered the art of stitchery. From the diary of Anna Green Winslow, written in 1771 and containing a record of a Boston school, comes the following account of a girl's duty for one day, the 9th of March, and it says, "A very snowy day. I have been a very good girl today about my work, however. In the first place, I sewed on the bosom of my uncle's shirt, mended two pairs of gloves, mended for the wash two handkerchiefs, in brackets one cambric, sewed on a half a border of a lawn apron of aunt's, read part of the 21st chapter of Exodus, and a story in the mother's gift." Fabric used was usually unbleached linen. Now let me just see here if I've got some. I think I've got some pictures somewhere of American samplers, but I think that might be in another book. I hope it is. Anyway, we shall see shortly. So that's that book. Now this one, Cross Stitch Calligraphy, A Practical Guide to Creating Samplers, Monograms and Personalised Gifts, Eva Polanski. And she's got a little bit in here on samplers also, the world of samplers. And she said professional embroiderers were almost or always male. That's what she found out. Different types of samplers. Oh, here we go. Darning samplers. A menial task was finding a place in the world of samplers. The act of mending a hole or a rent may seem unrelated to the noble art of embroidery, if it were not for the fact that in the 18th century, darning developed into a highly sophisticated skill. It is therefore of little surprise that darning patterns were made into samplers with the addition of rich borders and pictorial motifs. The darns were worked by a counted thread method with the material cut away underneath. Map samplers. The second half of the 18th century brought yet another innovation, the map sampler. The growing interest in travel found its echo in sampler making. Doubtless a map sampler was in theory an excellent way of becoming familiar with geography, although some of these maps are so inaccurate that they became testimony to the poor education their creators had received. On the other hand, there were very sophisticated maps embroidered over printed guidelines, which eliminated the possibility for errors. These maps were printed in black on white satin and surrounded by floral design. The fashion for map samplers spanned some 60 years, approximately from 1770 to 1830. And then there was the mourning samplers, the M-O-U-R NING samplers, another category of theme samplers born in the 18th century and surviving into the 19th was the mourning sampler. This was embroidered in memory of a deceased person, a family member or a dear friend. Mourning samplers usually depict gravestones, urns, mourners and the ever-present weeping willow, symbol of bereavement. The quality of the design ranges from a simple, naive rendering to a commissioned professional work. Mourning samplers were usually embroidered in silk on a satin or satin background. While most mourning samplers briefly stated the name of the deceased, his or her age, and the date of death, all preceded by "in memory of," some were more eloquent. One, obviously designed by a professional artist, depicts a praying nun in a church graveyard. The text on the tombstone reads, "Here lies the body of Mary Hazelton, born of Roman Catholic parents and virtuously brought up, who being in the act of prayer, repeating her vespers, was instantaneously killed by a flash of lightning, August the 16th, 1785, aged 9 years." And here are some examples of samplers here. The Lord's Prayer, and the one on this side, which I'll show you in a moment, all the elements of the traditional sampler are included here. Note the style of needlework was popular on both sides of the Atlantic in the 18th century. And this one on this side is from Newport, Rhode Island. So there's the Lord's Prayer. And this is the one from Newport, Rhode Island. Then so you always find something a little bit amusing. Whereas you get ones like an emblem of love. "In this my parents' love doth show, for learning they on me bestow. Now let me learn my God to fear and love him with a heart sincere." That was one of the verses for a sampler for a child to stitch. And this person here, Patty Poke, she says, "Patty Poke did this and she hated every stitch she did in it. She loves to read much more." So there were rebels even in those days, obviously. Now this magazine here, Needlework, June 1997. I've just included this because it has a Scottish sampler. A Scottish sampler worked in fine coloured wools. It includes rows of alphabets, numerals and family initials above a pictorial setting of a house, peacocks, trees and flowers. And it's got the meaning of motifs too there. Absolutely crammed in everything on there, isn't it? Adam and Eve are good and evil, angels martyrdom, apple love and fertility, butterfly or moth, immortality and resurrection, a cat is idleness, a cockerel is penitence. I'm sure you could see those on the internet, all the meanings of those various motifs. Now here's a little bit here about the Bronte sisters. I'm not a fiction person much, but I do like Jane Eyre, probably because it's based on truth anyway. Wouldn't surprise me. For a brief period, this is about the Haworth Parsonage that the Bronte sisters lived there with their father, and then when he died they lived there with their brother. For a brief period, all the daughters were sent to boarding school, but two elder sisters died there in 1825. The school was described for posterity as the dreadful Lowood in Jane Eyre by Charlotte. After that, the three surviving girls stayed at home in Haworth. Aunt Branwell gave them simple lessons and taught them sewing and home management. The numerous samplers still to be seen at the parsonage are dated from this period. Later in her life, Charlotte became a governess, which she hated, and which is also depicted in Jane Eyre. Emily preferred to tend her garden at Haworth and turned to the moors, to a life of mysticism and solitude. So this one here is Emily Bronte's sampler. In my view, the best Jane Eyre that was ever made starred Orson Welles. And he made the most magnificent Rochester. So if ever you get a chance, it's of course an old black and white one. It's excellent. And then this one here is a beautiful little purse that was made by Charlotte Bronte. At the time of her stay in Brussels, at a school, which later featured in the novel Villette. It is finely worked in a combination of flame, tent, and cross stitch. It looks modern, doesn't it? Like the stitching, it looks very fresh. And that's from the book Traditional Needlepoint by Frances Kennett and Belinda Scarlett. Right, now then, not many more. You know why I've got this one here? Oh, yes. Now this is a Victorian sampler. A record of all the different stitches. And it looks very fresh, doesn't it? I thought it was a copy, but it says here, the edges of the sampler are bound with green velvet. It says, a detail from a sampler worked on a long strip of narrow canvas during the first half of the 19th century. The edges of the sampler are bound with green velvet. At one end, there is a piece of black velvet embroidered with yellow silk in floral designs and lined with black satin. Originally, a wooden roller covered with black satin was attached to one end, and two olive green silk ribbons to the other. The sampler is worked in wool, silk, and silver gilt threads and gilt metal beads. The stitches include cross and long arm cross stitch, satin, herringbone, and so on. Berlin wool samplers, such as this one, show a range of stitches used by more advanced amateurs. These samplers were worked by professionals for amateurs to copy, and then often took the form of a small book or a narrow strip which was rolled up and kept in a workbox. So, it looks as though that could have been rolled up. It looks as though it's been all joined together, doesn't it, with the velvet. But anyway, I think that was all from that book. That was from Classic Needlework, Imogen Stewart. I think we're getting towards the end here. And this one here, The Gentle Arts. This is Jennifer Isaacs, 200 Years of Australian Women's Domestic and Decorative Arts. And there's just a little bit in here of a sampler that I thought was, because Australia was founded as a place to send, convicts from England. Well, supposedly that was the reason, but there were strategic reasons for sending people here to form a colony in this part of the world. But that's another thing altogether. But it was really just to show you this sampler here. That one. That's got the fancy work they used to have, well, still do. You know, competitions of who's the best stitcher. And there's a lady there doing some work. And it just says here, the oceans may between us roll and distance be our lot. Yet we may never meet again. Dear friend, forget me not. Sampler, 1878. The wording suggests it was a friendship sampler given as a gift in the late 19th century. And that's the Tasmanian Museum and Art Gallery. And then there was a picture that took me. It's not anything to do with cross stitch. And there weren't many items here, in the early days, you know, had to make do a lot, like any colony, anywhere. And this is a bush rug from Sooting by Minnie Stewart of Jamboree in the 1920s. And she's made a bed covering with parts of men's suits. Old suits. And there's something quite poignant about that. Well, I don't know, it makes me a little bit sad, but I'm not sure why. I think it's just, you know, all the work and just the mindset of the lady that did that. And the colours, the way she's coordinated it all. Yeah, just a little side thing. And I originally, when I was asked by Lisa Kay to do some work or find out a bit about samplers, I thought, well, I'm not really a sampler person. And then I thought, I have done one. I did one for my sister. Well, actually, my sister bought it thinking she was going to stitch it, but never did. So I stitched it. It was a kit. And there it is. I mean, I enjoyed doing it. But once was enough for me, I think. Unless I had a really good reason for doing another one. I mean, that looks a little bit like it would have been a school. But if I ever find the chart, I'll tell you where it came from. But I think it would be an Australian chart. Okay. Well, that was my version of samplers. And it's just such a huge topic, it really is. I mean, they said, in that magazine, that's what I meant to say, one of the reasons why it's got here about early samplers, and it just says, the extreme lack of specimens prior to 1648 supports the opinion that on the downfall of King Charles I, the Puritans destroyed every sampler they could lay their hands on. Well, of course, the Puritans, they didn't even like music. You know, that was Oliver Cromwell, that Charles I was beheaded, and Oliver Cromwell became protector of England. And during that time, they destroyed a lot of what they called Catholic blasphemy, is what they called it. They'd just go and destroy a lot of things in the church. They had to hide them. All the Catholics had to hide their treasures away. Well, he was running England, but Charles II came along and things changed again. How did I get onto that? Again, I get back onto the royal matters. Anyway, thank you very much for staying with me, if you've managed to do it. I am very grateful to Lisa Kay to give me the opportunity to look into samplers, which I probably wouldn't have done. I mean, I have the books there and I dip into them occasionally, but I didn't really, you know, look at them in a logical way of, or in a way of explaining why there was so much to do with mortality and all that sort of thing. All right then, well, until next time, happy stitching to you all. And I hope to see you again soon. Bye for now.